Good afternoon, learners. I welcome you all on behalf of myself and on behalf of Indira Gandhi National Open University. We are here once again after discussing two important topics. First is on data processing and other is on income tax. Today we are going to talk about IBO4, Export Import Procedure and Documentation. This is a very important course of Postgraduate Diploma International Business Operations. And we are here to discuss more about the terms of payment and export finance. In this topic, we are going to talk more about how the finances is going to play while export documentation and other aspects. We have with us today Professor Naval Kishore. He is a senior faculty in Department of Commerce, School of Management Studies. He had a vast experience in international business operations and other commerce topics like management, e-commerce and other topics. He is today with us to talk about all these things. I request Professor Naval Kishore, please carry on the session.
Good afternoon, participants. As Dr. Subodh has already introduced the subject matters, see, whenever you are exporting and importing, how to realize payment and how to get finance, these two areas are very important for you. Let us take the first one, that is called terms of payment. In the international business, what happens, as you all must be aware, that most of the transaction takes place on the credit basis. Now, when the transaction is based on the credit basis, then you need to understand the modalities of realizing the payment for that. Now, these terms of payment is not only relevant for realizing the payment, rather, it is also important to attract the buyers across the world. How attractive your terms of payment is, that helps you to attract the buyers, so that if the payment term is favorable for the buyers, you are expected to get more order for dispatching that particular product. If the terms of payment is favorable for the buyers, maybe the chances are that you may get order in different countries. So it is quite important to have attractive terms of payment, attractive methods of realizing payment, so that the buyers are being attracted for your terms of payment. For the foreign exchange regulations also, this terms of payment is important, because as per foreign exchange regulation, you need to make payment in a particular way. Now let us see what are the different methods of terms of payment. Look at the board. The first method is advance payment. As the name suggests, here what happens, you are providing, you are giving the payment in advance. For example, you are exporting the goods abroad. Now when you are exporting the goods abroad, now the buyer may ask you, you may ask the buyer to make the payment in advance itself before you dispatch the goods. So in the advance payment, as the name suggests, that before dispatching of the goods, the advance is being made to the exporters. Now this becomes the safest way of getting payment for the exporters. In this method, what you do, basically you may purchase a draft from the bank. What you can do, you may purchase a draft from the bank and make payment with the help of that draft. Second, you may go for the telegraphic transfer itself. In the telegraphic transfer, you send the payment from one place to other places. This is the most simplest way, because simplest way in the sense that the exporter get the advance payment through cash, through this draft or through telegraphic transfer. So it is a very simple way. Now payment is in your hand as an exporter, so it becomes easier for you to dispatch the goods. Next is, it is the most cheapest methods. It is the most cheapest method because in this method, the other commissions which are involved in the other methods like documentary credit and all that, those things won't be involved here. So it is considered as one of the most cheapest methods for making payment. But this is from the exporter point of view. When it comes to the exporters, what happens? When it comes to the importers, this becomes the most riskiest way of making payment from the importer's point of view. Because importers, they have not received any document, they have not received your goods, nothing else, but importers are making payment to you. So it becomes one of the most riskiest term for the importers, because importers are making payment well in advance without having anything in his or her hands. For example, without having documents or without having the goods. So therefore, once importers make payment, it becomes very difficult for the importers to dictate the terms and conditions. So advance payment is basically very helpful or very easiest or very good for the perspective of the exporter. But when it comes to the importers, then what happens in the importers, this is one of the most riskiest way of making payment from the importer side. Now let us come to the another method, and that is called the documentary credit. In fact, advanced method of payment is very restricted. Usually a very few persons they follow, the very few buyers or sellers they follow this advanced method. Most of now in the international transaction, in the international trade and business, most of the things are under the documentary credit system. And let us first see what documentary credit is all about. Basically, it is any arrangement whereby a bank acting at the request and in accordance with the instructions of a customer, the importer undertakes to make payment to or to the order of a third party, the exporter, against stipulated documents and compliance with stipulated terms and conditions. Compliance with stipulated. So, here what happens? Basically, this is an arrangement between the two parties. Arrangement means that one party requests in accordance with the instructions of a customer, and here the customer is importer, and the one party undertakes to make payment to or to the order of a third party. That means the third party, that is the exporter when he orders, but it should be against stipulated documents. Against stipulated documents means whatever the documents are being specified, those documents you need to submit. First, those documents you need to submit, and second is the compliance with stipulated terms and conditions. So the first thing is, there is a instructions. When the instructions is there, based on that instruction, one party instructs the other or third party to make payment. Second thing is stipulated documents. That means whatever documents are being specified, those documents, you need to submit those documents. And the third is stipulated terms and conditions. In the stipulated terms and conditions, what happens? Based on that terms and conditions, you need to make the payment to be released based on the stipulated terms and conditions. Now see, here is an arrangement whereby a bank acting at the request, and you just note down this area, any arrangement whereby a bank acting at the request and in accordance with the instructions of a customer, the importer, undertakes to make payment to or to the order of a third party, the exporter, against stipulated documents and compliance with stipulated terms and conditions. Now in the documentary credit, you see, as I said, that these three things are important in the documentary credit. Now let us see that parties in documentary credits. Now what are the parties in the documentary credits? Firstly, importer, that is an applicant. First party is your importer and he is considered as an applicant because importer receives this, so importer is considered as applicant. Second party is your opening or issuing banker. Opening or issuing banker, that banker in the, what happens, issuing banker, the banker, what the banker doing, the banker issues the, what is called the documentary credits. The credit is being issued by the banker. So the first party is your importer, that is an applicant. Second party is your opening or issuing banker. Opening or issuing banker means it is a bank who issues the credit. Third party is your advising banker. Advising banker means, you, as you all must be aware, that in the advising banker what happens, advises banker, it advises about the credit worthiness. All over the world there are some advising bankers who may be maintaining some sort of record or who may be in touch with that party, so it is called advising banker, who advises about the credit worthiness. Fourthly, confirming banker. In the confirming banker, it is a banker who confirms the credit. Banker who confirms the credit means, now this bank, he or it takes the responsibility of making payment in whenever there is any mishappening. So in that case, it takes the responsibility to make payment. So fourth is your confirming banker who confirms the credit. Next is your fifth is your paying banker. The bank who makes the payment is known as paying banker. Sixthly, it is a negotiating bank. In the negotiating bank, what happens? The bank which is involved in negotiating the credit, and that is called the negotiating bank. And finally, the exporter. Exporter is beneficiary. It's called beneficiary. So exporter is the beneficiary one. Now let us see that when the payment is made under the letter of credit arrangement, then what should be, what details are being included in the letters of credit. Just you see, the first is your name of the issuing bank. Second, on whose behalf the credit is being issued. Third, the amount, that is how much the credit involves. Next is your, the date for that particular credit. Next is the terms of the draft. What are the terms of that particular draft? Next is your named bank or the buyer. Who is that banker about that? Next is your details of the goods. What are the details of that particular goods? Next is your documents required. What are the documents required for that particular goods? Next is your ports of shipment and destination of shipment, that from which ports the shipment is going to take place and where the shipment is going to reach. Next is your price in terms of shipment. What is the price of that particular product, that particular consignment, and what are the terms of shipment? There may be different terms of shipment, in what conditions, how, where, so on and so forth. There are different terms which are involved here, so that terms of shipment. Whether the part shipment allowed, whether the part shipment is allowed or not. Any other conditions, if there is any other conditions, so those conditions may be specified in the letters of credit. Next is your issuing bank's responsibility in the credit. What is the responsibility of issuing bank in that particular credit? Next is your subject to the provisions of the uniform customs and practices for documentary credits. What, under what this, whatever conditions are, those should be under uniforms, customs and practices for documentary credits. Now let us see the practical mechanism, how it actually happens. The buyer and seller agree terms of sale. What happens? Both buyer and seller, they agree the terms of the sale, that under what condition they are going to sell something. Second is issuing bank to issue the credit. Second party is there, that they request the issuing bank to issue the credit. Third is your, the issuing bank instructs the advising or confirming bank. What happens? The issuing bank instructing the advising or the confirming bank about that particular credit. The advising bank informs the beneficiary. When the advising bank is being informed, now the advising bank, what it does, it informs the beneficiary, that is the exporter. The beneficiary arranges shipment. What happens? The beneficiary who arranges now the shipment. And then the seller obtains the bill of lading and other required documents. Now when the shipment takes place, when the goods are being already shipped, after shipment what happens? Now the seller informs the beneficiary and the documents, his bill of lading and whatever those documents are being dispatched. Now importer may get that documents and then the payment may be released. The bank now checks the documents. What happens? The bank checks the documents. The issuing bank checks them, releases them to the buyer. The issuing bank checks those documents and that being releases to the buyer. The buyer uses the documents to get possession of the goods. Now what the buyer is doing? The buyer uses the documents to get the possession of the goods. Now before we go, let us see it with the help of a diagram. That means what happens in a documentary credit, there may be at least four parties, and the four parties are: the one is your seller, who is known as beneficiary; the second party is your buyer, who is known as an applicant; the third party is your issuing bank, and the fourth party is your advising, confirming or negotiating bank. So let us see the first party, that is your seller. Obviously seller and buyer, there are two parties. The buyer and seller enter into a sales contract. Both enters into a sales contract providing for payment by documentary credit. That means the buyer and seller enters into a contract which provides for payment by documentary credit. Now after that, the buyer instructs his bank, that is the issuing bank, to issue a credit in favor of seller. Now what buyer is doing? Buyer is instructing his bank to issue the credit in favor of the seller. So first they are entering about this aspect of the sale, that is called the sales contract. So now second, the buyer is instructing his bank, that is called issuing bank, to issue a credit in favor of the seller. Now what issuing bank does? Issuing bank asks another bank, usually in the country of the seller, to advise or confirm the credit. Now what issuing bank is doing? The issuing bank asks another bank, usually in the country of the seller, to advise or confirm the credit. Now obviously the advising bank, confirming bank, negotiating bank, sometimes all three may be together also. So there are different banks who are experienced in this area, in this way of advising, confirming or negotiating. So what happens? They ask these banks to advise, confirm or negotiate the credit. Once it is done, the advising or confirming bank informs the seller that the credit has been issued. Now advising or confirming bank, what they are doing? They inform the seller that the credit has been issued. So now once they inform the seller the credit has been issued, so now the shipment is being taken place. The way shipment, we'll be discussing a little later about this aspect.
Here I would like to say, so it's basically a link between the seller and the issuing bank. So and this is go with certain process.
See, not only a link, rather it is a process. It is a process where one party instructs the other party, or the buyer asks the issuing bank to issue a credit in favor of the seller.
Right.
So buyer instructs, buyer requests the issuing bank to issue a credit in favor of the seller. Now there are the terms and conditions associated with that, and if all those terms or conditions are being followed, in that case only the goods are being supplied and payment will be made to other party. Now see how the works, how this whole mechanism works. The buyer and seller agree terms of sale. Whatever is the terms of sale, you know the sale when two parties, buying or selling party, the buyer and the seller, they must agree about that terms of sale. So both of them agree that terms of sale. Then issuing bank issue the credit. Whatever is the issuing bank, the issuing bank issue the credit. The issuing bank instructs the advising or confirming bank. The issuing bank now instructs the advising and confirming bank either to advise the credit, that means the credit, the one bank is advising about the credit, and maybe there may be another confirming bank, or both may be same also. Now confirming bank confirms the credit. Confirming the credit means what's happening, the if there is a problem in the payment, then the confirming bank will make payment. The advising bank informs the beneficiary, that is exporter. The beneficiary arranges shipment. What beneficiary does? Beneficiary arranges the shipment procedure. The seller obtains the bill of lading and the other required documents. Then the seller obtains the bill of lading and other required documents. The bank checks the documents. Bank now checks, scrutinizes the documents. The issuing bank checks them, releases them to the buyer, and issuing bank also now checking them, and that is being released to the buyer. The buyer uses the documents to get possession of the goods. Now what the buyer is doing, the buyer uses that documents to get the possession of the goods. Now the documents are in sent through the bank to the buyer. Now that buyer, once the buyer receives the document, then what the buyer does, that document is known as the bill of lading. So with the help of that bill of lading, once the buyer receives and buyer promises to make payment, then in that case what happens, buyer receives the goods and asks the bank to make the payment. Now let us see the letter of credit, different kinds of letter of credit. In the different kinds of letter of credit, what happens? The first kind, there are various kinds of letter of credit. The first kind is your revocable and irrevocable letter of credit. Under the revocable letter of credit, what happens? There is a scope for the change. That means one party may change the credit, that may modify that letter of credit and make certain changes. This is called revocable letter of credit. And under the irrevocable letter of credit, what happens? The credit is irrevocable. Irrevocable means there is no change possible. There is no possibility of any change in the letter of credit. Therefore, it is called irrevocable letter of credit. And obviously, the party or bank prefers irrevocable letter of credit, because as you all know that if you go for the revocable letter of credit, then as the name suggests, there is a scope for change in the letter of credit. Second is your confirmed letter of credit. Confirmed letter of credit means that there is a possibility for confirmation. There is a possibility of confirmation in that letter of credit. What happens here, the one party, another requests the other party to confirm the credit. Confirm the credit means that if there is any mishappening, if there is any problem, in that case what happens, the party, the confirming party is able to make payment for that purpose. So this is called confirmed letter of credit, because confirmation is being granted here. Then is your next, your restricted credit. Under the restricted credit, what happens? The credit is issued, is restricted in by a named bank. That means here you name the, take the name of the bank, therefore it is called restricted credit. Next is your revolving credit. Sometimes what happens, you are making shipment regularly or continuing shipments are made by the seller. In that case, it may be available even after the credit has been utilized once. So it is called revolving credit. Next is your red clause letter of credit. Here what happens, it is basically nature of pre-shipment finance given to the seller by the buyer. So here what happens, basically beneficiary is allowed to draw an advance against shipment. Next is your transferable credit. In the transferable credit what happens, beneficiary, this enables beneficiary to make the credit available in whole or part. Basically it happens when one or more or third parties are involved. So in that case, it is used when the seller is a middleman who transfers part of the credit to supplier who ships the goods. So credit can be transferred only once. Sometimes what happens in the export-import business, there is a middleman also involved in that. So when there is a middleman involved, so in that case, what you do? There may be the possibility of transferring of the credit from one person to other person. So it is called transferable credit. Next is your back-to-back letter of credit. Sometimes what happens, the beneficiary of an irrevocable letter of credit may not be the actual supplier of the goods. Then in that case, he will request his banker to open a further letter of credit. So it is called back-to-back letter of credit. So in the back-to-back letter of credit, what happens, there is a third party. Now you get the credit. Now there is a supplier involved in that. When there is a supplier involved in that, so part of the credit, now what you are doing, you are parting the requesting again the bank to issue the part of the credit in the name of that particular supplier. So this is called back-to-back letter of credit. Next is your standby credit. Just see here, back-to-back credit, after back-to-back credit, you have next a standby credit. So what happens, this assured the beneficiary that in the event of non-performance or non-payment of an obligation, the beneficiary may request payment from the issuing banker. So it is called a standby credit. Next is your deferred payment credit. Obviously, as you must be aware about the name suggest, that there is a deferred credit payment system. So deferred credit payment system is basically the long-term credit payment system. So it is a long-term credit system, so buyer has some time to make payment, so it is called deferred payment credit. Next, your payment and acceptance credit. As the name suggests, when it is payment credit, so payment credit means the site credit. That means at the site what happens, whenever you see the credit itself, the bill itself, so you need to make payment, so it is called payment credit. Acceptance credit, what happens in the acceptance credit, there is a time limit, there is a time gap, some time is allowed, this is called usance also. So you get some time, once it is accepted, once the credit is being accepted, so it is called the acceptable credit. Next is your negotiation credit. In the negotiation credit, what happens, there is a scope for negotiation, so it is called negotiation credit. Next is your site and usance credit. In the site and usance credit, what happens, in the site, as the payment credit site name suggests, that immediate payment is being made when the draft is, when the bill is under site. And when the bill is under usance credit, the second one form, in the usance credit, what happens? Under the usance credit, the time period is permitted. There is a time period being allowed, time period, then it's called usance credit. Next is your fixed and revolving credit. In the fixed credit, what happens? The amount is fixed. So it is called fixed credit, and time period is also fixed. So therefore it is called fixed credit. And in the revolving credit, again, when you keep on exporting the things, so amount is reviving or reinstated without requiring any rehancement in the credit. So it is called fixed and revolving credit. Next is your transit credit. In the transit credits, what happens, this is issued in one foreign currency with beneficiary in another, but is advised through an usually confirmed bank in London. So there is a confirmed bank in London, so that is advised by them. Next is your, what are the documents required under letter of credit. In the letter of credit, you have bill of exchange, you have commercial invoice, you have packing list, you have transport document, you have inspection certificate, you have insurance policy / certificate, then you have documents against payment, as earlier it was discussed also, that in the documents against payment, whatever payment is being released once you receive the documents. So here what happens, exporter draws a bill of exchange on the buyer payable at site. The bill is payable at site. The documents are to be surrendered to the importer only upon payment of the bill. When the bill is being make payment by the importer, then only the documents will be provided to the importer. Once importer receive the documents, make the payment and receive the documents, this is called documents against payment. Next is your documents against acceptance. In the documents against acceptance methods, what happens, again here the bill is drawn, but that bill is usance bill, that is called usance bill. And that bill is being forwarded along with the documents to the importer. Now when importer receives that, then what importer does, importer accepts that bill. When importer accepts that bill, so what happens, as a result of acceptance of that bill, the documents are being released to the importer. Now by accepting the bill only, that he received the documents and he receives the, and he writes there accepted and puts his signature there. So this is called documents against acceptance. Next is your open account with provisions for periodic settlement. Sometimes what happens, you have the long term relationship between the buyer and seller. When there is a long term relationship between the buyer and seller and you are familiar with the overseas buyer, you know the overseas buyer well, in that case what you do, there is a regular supply of the goods from one party to other party, and when you are supplying the goods from one party to other party, what happens there, now after a particular period you get the settlement of those bill. So it is a regular process, but this process is when the buyer and seller closely know each other. Next is shipment on consignment basis. What happens, you send the consignment to other party and other party receives the consignment. Other party when receives the consignment, then what other party does with that consignment, they dispose that, they sell that product in their own country, and then when they realize the payment out of that, then they send the payment to you. So these are the methods for the payment in the international business. Now out of this, obviously the documentary credit method is the most prevalent way of the making payment. Now let us go to the another interesting area, and that is your export finance. As you all must be aware that in the export finance there are two types of finance available to you. One is pre-shipment finance and other is post-shipment finance. What happens? Pre-shipment finance, it is basically provided to exporters for the purchase of raw materials, processing them and converting them into finished goods for the purpose of export. So what happens when you get the export order? When you get the export order, you must be thinking that how to process the good, how to manufacture the goods. So in order to process the goods and manufacture the goods, what happens, the raw materials must be converted into the finished products. So for this process, you get, what do you get for this process? You get the finance from the bank at the concessional rate. So this is called pre-shipment finance. Now pre-shipment finance is available to you on the, there are three basic methods of this pre-shipment finance. First is your packing credit. So packing credit is again provided to you for the, basically this is a loan to the exporter for financing the purchase, processing, manufacturing and packing of the goods for the purpose of the export. So now this packing credit, the eligibility for this packing credit is, you both merchant exporters, star export houses, the trading export houses, manufacturers of the goods supplying to export houses and sub suppliers, all of them are eligible for getting this packing credit. Next is your running account facility. Sometimes what happens, you need credit without lodgement of LC or firm order contract under the scheme of running account facility. But under the scheme of running account facility, it must comply the following conditions. The first condition is there should be need for running account facility, which should be established by the exporters, and bank must be satisfied for this purpose. Second is the track record of the exporter must be good. Third is the LC firm order is produced within a reasonable period of time. Next is your credit available in respect of individual pre-shipment credit should not go beyond 180 days. It should not go beyond 180 days. Now as far as amount is concerned, the amount of packet credit will not exceed FOB value of export of goods or their domestic value, whichever is less. That means domestic value of goods, even though such value is higher than the FOB value. So what happens, sometimes the domestic value may be of the goods may be higher than the FOB value of goods. As you all know that in that case there may be certain incentives from the government of India, and that is known as the duty drawback incentive. So based on that, that much amount you get. If the higher is also there, then you get that amount. But usually, whichever is less, you get the pre-shipment credit on that basis. Now, as far as the period of the pre-shipment credit is concerned, the maximum period is of 180 days from the date of disbursement of that credit from the bank. But if the bank is satisfied, it can be further extended for the 90 days, provided the bank must be satisfied with that causes, whatever logic you provide, the bank must be satisfied for that. Next is your rate of interest. Obviously, the rate of interest is subsidized here. Next is your advance against incentives. As I said you, that if the FOB domestic value is higher than the FOB value of the your export products, then in that case, maybe you might be, incentives may be involved, and that incentive is known as duty drawback for the exporter. So what happened, the excess of cost of production over the FOB value of the contract represents incentives receivable. So that difference is known as the duty drawback. So you may get finance, you may get the credit from the bank based on your that duty drawback structure. Next is pre-shipment credit in foreign currency. Now there is two provision here. One is pre-shipment credit in rupees, and then the post-shipment credit either in rupees or in foreign currency denominated credit. Or the second may be the exporters may avail pre-shipment credit in foreign currency and discount or rediscount the export bills in foreign currency. So in foreign currency also pre-shipment credit may be allowed to you. Now let us come to the another method, and that is called the post-shipment finance. Post-shipment finance refers to any loan or advance granted or any other credit provided by a bank to an exporter of goods from India from the date of extending the credit after shipment of goods to the date of realization of export proceeds. As the definition suggests that after the shipment, and when you have not realized the payment, the time gap, you have a time gap and you may need some finance for your business purposes. So the post-shipment finance is also provided by the government or by the bank so that you may meet the requirement when your amount is held up from the date of shipment and from the realization of export proceeds. Now the types of, there are various types of again methods of post-shipment finance which is available to you. One is negotiation of export documents under letters of credit. Here what happens, the conditions of the letter of credit must be conformity, whatever is there, whatever is the requirement of the bank. Then the terms and conditions must be there, bank must satisfy the terms and conditions. Next is your, whatever the documents are required, those documents must be submitted. If there is any slightest deviation from those things, then the bank may not make payment. Next is your purchase or discount of foreign bills. What happens, sometimes the party may have the limit for the purchase or discounting limits sanctioned by the bank.
there is a limit which is being sanctioned by the bank, so the party may be having that limit, and based off that limit, the party may go for the purchase or discount of foreign bills. Obviously, ECGC policy may be issued in favor of exporters in that way. Next is your advance against bills sent on collection. Sometimes what happens, the advance is also granted on the basis of bills sent on collection. What is it in the following situations? One is purchase limit is exhausted. Second is LC may have some discrepancies. And third is there may be the customary practice also. So for this purpose, you may get advance against bills sent on collection. Next is your advance against goods sent on consignment. Sometimes you send the goods on the consignment basis, and here also, based on that, you get the advance. Next is your advance against export incentives. As I said you earlier also, that sometimes the prices may be higher, and in that case the difference may be the incentives being received by the government, and based on that incentives, amount of the incentives, you may get the advance from the bank, and that is also called under advance against export incentives. Next is your advance against undrawn balances. What happens sometimes, bills are not drawn to the full value of the goods. What happens, a small part of the bill is left undrawn for payment, and which after the adjustment of maybe weight, quality, etc. So it is a customary that maybe sometimes you are not allowing the drawing the full value of the goods, so partly it being undrawn. So in that case, based on partly, but that should be the subject of maximum of 5% usually. So in that case, you get the advance, the finance one. Next is your advance against retention money. Sometimes some of the money is being retained there, and based on that also you get the advance. Next is your post-shipment export credit guarantee and export finance. This is the scheme of the ECGC. Next is the post-shipment credit in foreign currency. You may get post-shipment credit in foreign currency also. So these were the different method of post-shipment finance. Now if you have any query, you can ask the questions. Otherwise, we can sum up the discussion.
Thank you, Professor Naval Kishore. It was really a thought-provoking learning on the topic, which is very contemporary nowadays. What you have talked about, that is advance payment related to how it is going to give benefit to the exporter, parties in documentary credit, process from issuing bank to supplier, different mechanism. You have very elaborately talked about letter of credit. ECGC was also discussed. Sir, it was really a very learning thing for all of us. I hope learners will get a great benefit from it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Subodh. Thank you, participants.